Scripture passage this morning is taken from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15, reading from verses 1 to 32. Verse 1. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear him. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Then Jesus told them this parable. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Does he not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep." I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. Or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Does she not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost coin." In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the estate.' So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, 'How many of my father's hired men have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men."' Verse 20, so he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him and kissed him. The son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." But the father said to his servants, "Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. "Your brother has come," he replied, "and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound." The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, "Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours who has squandered your property with prostitutes comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him." "My son," the father said, "you are always with me and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." May the Lord bless the public reading of his word. The Lord's messenger this morning is Pastor Stephen.
Thank you, Faith, for reading the word of God for us. My message this morning is on the flu. This morning's sermon is not meant to make you feel sick, but it may get you down. And if you do feel down, you will usually get up again, and you will usually feel stronger after that. Just like after you've been hit with the flu bug, you come back stronger than ever. This morning, the flu is not caused by the influenza virus. It is caused by what Luke recorded for us in chapter 15, Luke, incidentally, is a doctor, and he writes about the flu to challenge us with this question: where are you now, and what can you do about it? We're continuing our series in the Gospel of Luke, which began last year, and we've been looking at the certainty of Jesus as our Savior. But some were not as certain as to who Jesus was, mainly because of his associations, the fact that Jesus ate with sinners and welcomed them. So we have come to today's passage on the three parables in Luke chapter 15, which are usually characterized as the lost sheep, the lost coin, and the lost son. And upon closer examination, we will find that there are actually three sets of threes in the three parables. The three parties can be called the lost sheep, the lost sheep, the lost coin, the lost son, the finder, the shepherd, the woman, and the father, and the unlost, the 99 sheep, the 9 coins, and the elder son. So what do you have when you put it together? L-F-U, which doesn't sound quite right, so I'll change it to flu. In today's sermon, then, I want to suggest that when you have been saved, you will think about the F.L.U., which is the outline in your bulletin, if you want to follow along. But let us pray as we ask the Lord to speak to us and direct our thoughts as we listen to His Word being preached. Our Father, it is indeed our joy and our privilege to be here in Your house to worship You and to hear Your Word being preached about the living Word of God, about our Lord Jesus Christ and how He came into the world to save lost sinners. We want to thank You for Your Spirit who opens our eyes to see these truths and who opens our hearts to receive our Lord Jesus. May Your Spirit work mightily in our midst this morning. We pray and ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So, when you have been saved, you think about the lost. This is where we usually begin in our spiritual journey toward God and towards being saved. We usually start out feeling lost. Have you ever had that sense of being at a loss, where you do not know where you're going in your life, and where you feel that things are not going well for you? Well, if you ever had that feeling, it's very likely because God is working in your heart. He is calling you to Himself. And I remember how it hit me. I had led a rather comfortable life until that point in 1976. Then suddenly, I began to feel that I was at a loss. I felt like I didn't know what was going to happen next to me. And I remember it was such an uncomfortable feeling that I began to search for God. So in these parables, then, we consider, first of all, the lost sheep, the lost coin, the lost son, the lost sheep. There's not much we can say about the lost sheep because we're not told the story from the sheep's perspective. An imaginative mind could spin up a tale and entitle it, "The Day I Lost the Way," a short story by the sheep which was found by Jesus. Or we could look at the lost coin. An even more interesting story could be told by the lost coin. What was it trying to do on the day when it got lost? Well, that would probably be another bestseller given people's appetite for the sensational. And then we have the lost son. We are privileged to know what we know about this lost son. We've also heard some of our best sermons from speakers whom we have invited to preach on this passage. But because we already know so much about the lost son, it's very challenging for me to know what to do with this passage. So I've assembled the following things to just move us along. Well, the son, he requested his share of the inheritance from his father, which his father gave to him, even though at that point the son's intentions were not declared. Then the son left for a far country. With much resources, he wanted to experience the good life. That experiment unfortunately, did not last long. Why? Because two disasters hit him. First, he ran out of money, and then he ran into a famine. So bad was the situation that he sank to the lowest of the low. He fed swine for wages, and this was a reprehensible occupation for a Jew. But then, there, down in the dumps, he came to his senses, and he started heading home with his apology carefully worked out. For the rest of the story, let us wait to meet the Father. For now, let me ask you, do you identify with the lost? Are we like the lost sheep, wandering aimlessly, looking for better pasture, and not realizing that our great shepherd already has the best pasture for us with green grass and clear, clean water for us already? Or are we like the lost coin, lost in some dark, cold corner, thinking that the world has forgotten all about us, that no one would ever find us again? Or are we like the lost son? Perhaps like this lost son, we've also had a chance to do something significant, but we know we have blown it so badly. So badly that we wonder, how can anyone, even a loving father, how can anyone ever forgive us for the grievous hurt that we have caused to them? Do you identify with the lost? For if you do, you're actually in good company. There are many here today who, though they may have attended church for a while, for even a long while, who are still lost as far as the purposes and the plan of God for their lives is concerned, for they have yet to return to God. So once we have been saved, we look back and we marvel at how lost we had been and how God would go through such lengths to find us. But perhaps right now, we're still feeling lost, wondering what happens next. Well, when you have been saved, you begin to think about the finders. And this is where our spiritual journey takes us next, namely to a greater appreciation of God, whom we realize has reached out to save us. So, we first started out feeling lost. And in our lostness, we cry out, we reach out, and we find ourselves then being saved. And if you have been saved or found, you will know that feeling. It is as though everything in your life has changed for you. Everything is now going well for you. Not perfect, of course, but better. And you can see a reason for what has happened to you or what is happening to you. And somehow you know, or you gradually come to know, that it is God who has been working in your heart and in your life. And I remember how it was for me. At that point of feeling so lost, God used a Bible which I had borrowed from a girlfriend whom I was interested to get to know better, but alas, she was not interested in me. And that is the story of my life, repeated many times until I met Li Tiang. Anyway, through reading the Bible, through attending church, which happened to be the Zion BP Church in Serangoon Gardens, and through the ministry of the Youth Fellowship, God broke through that facade that I erected and saved me. Hallelujah. Thank God for the youth ministry in churches. Praise God that God is calling youth to Himself. So in these parables, we encounter, secondly, the finders, namely the shepherd, the woman, and the father. The shepherd, he spares no effort to find the lost sheep. In fact, he leaves the 99 to fend for themselves in the wilderness, as we read in the passage just now. And the joy of the shepherd is so evident. And the joy of the shepherd is so evident when he finally locates the lost sheep and brings it back to his fold. He calls his friends and neighbors together and tells them, celebrate with me because I found my lost sheep. How about that woman? She is very determined to find the lost coin. She lights a candle, probably because the houses back then were very dim, and she sweeps and sweeps until she finds a lost coin. As we read in the passage just now, she also calls her friends and relatives together, the neighbors together, to celebrate with her. The joy and the pride of the woman knows no bounds. For the coin, which was a drachma, probably worth a day's wages, you had to work a whole day just to earn that amount, and it probably meant much to her in a poor condition. Once again, her joy is freely shared with her friends and neighbors. And what about that father? He is waiting and scanning the horizon, waiting on a daily basis for his lost son to return. The story is long, and we are somewhat familiar with it, but here's the climax. But whilst he, the prodigal son, was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him profusely. Then the son tried to say out his full apology. He only managed to say the first part when the father said to the servant, come, bring the best robe, put the ring on him, put the sandals on him. These are all tokens of him being restored back to the family, restored back to that position of authority within the household, for the father would not entertain his son being just a servant. We are told that such behavior, as noted by the scholars, is uncommon for patriarchs, particularly for fathers who have been so rudely offended by the inconsiderate actions of prodigal sons. But this father, he doesn't care about protocol. He doesn't care about proper manners. He's simply delighted that his precious son has come home. Coming home. Have you ever been away from home for a long time and then finally you're allowed to go home? It's like, maybe you were in camp training. Or do you remember when you finally were allowed to go home after 3 weeks of in camp training or 3 months of in camp training? Or maybe you were away on an overseas assignment and due to unusual circumstances, you could only go home after 3 years. Do you remember how it felt when you first saw that familiar door? There's no place like home. And what makes home so special are the ones who love us, our parents, our siblings, and in this case, God. These three parties in these three parables, we see the joy of God when the lost sinner is found. And we know that Jesus has come to seek and to save that which is lost. And Jesus spares no effort until the lost is found. How grateful we must be that our God would go through such lengths in order to bring the sinner back to himself. Indeed, each one of us who is here today, who knows the saving grace of our Lord Jesus, we can testify to the tenacity with which our Lord Jesus has sought us and wooed us into his kingdom. Praise be to God. Once we have been saved, we look back and we marvel at the love of the finder, that God would go through such lengths to find us. But if you are still not saved, you really don't want to miss out on the joy of coming home to God. Thirdly, when you have been saved, you think about the unlost. This is where, unfortunately, our spiritual journey can take us once we have been saved. We gradually forget what it was like when we had been lost. Now that we have been in the house of the Lord for a while, we can unknowingly behave like the unlost. Or we may have been in the house of the Lord for so long that we cannot even remember the time before we came to the house when we were not yet in the house of the Lord. There is truly a danger of feeling unlost. The last of the three parties in these three parables are not easy to deal with, but maybe let me try and explain this concept of the unlost first. The unlost conveys a mystical sense of being not lost, but still lost. For the elder brother, it was that sense of being near, but not dear to the father. And this is where I sometimes sense myself wandering into once in a while. It's that sense of taking grace for granted. I'm sure you feel sometimes that way too. It's that sense of jealousy when you hear of others expressing such great joy and delight over the work of God in their lives. But you wonder, how come God never blessed me like that now? How come God doesn't work in the same way? We don't have those same delighted feelings about God's work in our own life. If you have been saved for a while, perhaps you need to examine whether there's this sense of the unlost in you. So let's look at each one of these three unlost. First, the unlost sheep. What could be said about these 99 unlost sheep? Well, one thing that we could say is that they have never experienced the joy of being carried in joy on the shoulders of the shepherd, simply because they've never been lost. I remember how in the army, we had to do this evacuation exercise, and you had to pretend to be one of the wounded lying on the field, and then your buddy would come and pick you up and put you on the shoulder. Wow, so shocked to be carried on the shoulder out of the scene of action because your buddy doesn't want to leave you dying on the field. And then the instructor would shout, okay, switch. Then jialat, you have to carry your buddy. That sense of joy. And as we read, he calls his neighbors and friends, rejoice with me, for I've found my lost sheep. And I tell you, in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. The other 99 sheep are the self-righteous ones because they do not need to repent. How about the unlost coins? The same could be said about the 9 unlost coins. They never had this experience of being found after a period of being lost. You see, when a person finds something which he thought he had lost for good, there's that new sense of joy and pride in possessing that thing again. That newly found coin is rubbed and hugged and even kissed if the owner is emo enough. And, I never thought I'd find you again. And the 9 unlost coin, they're so poor thing. They simply cannot imagine so much emo over one coin. For we read, the woman calls her friends, rejoice with me, I found my lost coin. In the same way, I tell you, there's rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. Very interesting is that we are given this idea that what happens here on earth is a mirror image, is an insight into what happens in heaven. That as much as we rejoice over something lost that is found, there is rejoicing in heaven among the angels when one sinner is found and repents and comes back to God. In both instances, we note the rejoicing of the angels over one sinner who repents. And you know, this is even more remarkable in that this particular note about the angels rejoicing is missing from the third parable, the third parable about the lost son, because we cannot imagine sheep or coin repenting, but we are told that this younger son, he feels absolutely miserable about his wrong choice of action, and he wants to get right with his father again. And that's what repentance is all about, feeling the wrong and wanting to get it right. But we are not told that there is rejoicing in heaven when the son returns. So we assume because the parables are in a set, that is also true. Now we come to the unlost son. We know how the unlost son felt when his prodigal brother came home. We saw how he had expressed his disapproval of the lavish way in which the father has treated this son of yours. He could not even acknowledge him as my brother. We also know how he had professed, "Look, all these years, I've been slaving for you, and I never disobeyed your orders, yet you never even gave me a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, and you kill the fattened calf for him. So unfair." Perhaps what makes us most sorry for him is that he has never experienced this love, this kind of love which his father lavished on the lost son, because he has never been lost. Sadly, the elder son only saw the father as a taskmaster. "All you do is tell me, do my homework, do my work, get this done, get that done." He has never seen himself as a son. He has only seen himself as a slave. Indeed, he is the unlost son, as defined earlier. He is near the father, but not dear to the father. So, do we identify with the unlost? Are we like these 99 sheep, feeling indignant and angry over that one sheep that went astray and making the rest of us having to stay here and wait till the shepherd finally comes back for us? How could that one sheep be so selfish? It's unlikely that they felt they could rejoice with that lost sheep that is now found. Or how about those 9 coins, feeling frustrated because no attention was paid to them? It was all given instead to that lost coin. All because that one coin got careless and got lost again. How could you be so careless? It's unlikely that they felt like rejoicing over the lost coin that's now found. And what about the elder son? You know, it has been said that the proud and the self-righteous always feel that they are not treated as well as they deserve. You agree? If you're proud and you're self-righteous, you always feel that you're not treated as well as you deserve. You could almost hear him say of his father, "This man, my father, welcomes sinners and eats with them," just as the Pharisees had said of Jesus. After getting used, you know, sometimes after getting used to the grace, the lavish grace of God, it is possible to become unfeeling towards the plight of sinners who need to repent and return to God. It is possible to get upset when grace is shown to the undeserving. So once you have been saved, we may become unlost and ungracious in the way we feel about others who have been so far away from God and who are now coming back to God. And yet for us, even for us in our unlost state, God is still reaching out to us. So the question is, where are you now? And what can you do about it? For Luke tells us the reason why Jesus tells these parables, when he noted that now the tax collectors and the sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, they muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them. The focus then of these parables was on the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, who, like the elder brother, they are the unlost sheep, unlost coins. It's often assumed that in church there are two groups of people. There are, first of all, the lost, that you are now far away from God. You know deep down inside your heart that you've blown it, that you wasted your life in wanton living. Please note, not wanton living, it's wanton living. And you're now down in the dumps. But you know, it's not too late, it's never too late to come back to God. And He is waiting to welcome you into His everlasting arms, for He wants to forgive you and to reinstate you so that you are a part of His family again. It's assumed that there's one part and the other part is the unlost, that you've never been far away from God, but unknowingly you've grown distant from God. You no longer get excited about thinking about how much the Father loves you. You are faithful in your relationship, but unfortunately that relationship has become a chore. It is not too late. It's never too late to accept the hand of God extended to you to come back joyfully to the Father. But be careful. You may not even know what you're missing out by keeping your distance from God and from those who are coming back to God. It's often assumed that there are two groups in church, but in reality, there's a third group in church. Today, albeit this is a rather small group, it is an important group. This group identifies with being the finder or the father. Your relationship with God is on an even keel. You're not far away from God, neither do you feel estranged from God. If anything, you feel like God has put you into this community to show mercy to all. Praise God. Continue to express the love of God to others, continue to show mercy to all, continue to express a welcoming love of God to the lost and to the unlost. For there will always be many lost and lonely souls in the church. There are always prodigal sons and daughters waiting to be welcomed back to God. Please help to welcome them back. And unfortunately, there will also be the unlost, the self-righteous people who need to be reminded of the true nature of God. Whichever category you're in, and sometimes we find ourselves moving in and out of this and that, the other category, God continues to eat with sinners, and He welcomes those who repent. He wants us to repent, so let us also learn to eat with sinners. The flu. Once you've had the flu and you get over it, you come back stronger and often wiser. And so it is with our salvation. This passage is about God's welcoming love for sinners who repent. Coming back stronger after a bout of flu. After you've been saved, you understand the joy of the shepherd, the joy of the woman, the joy of the Father, which are well recorded for us. But the shepherd and the woman say, "Rejoice with me, I have found the lost sheep, the lost coin." And in the same way, there's rejoicing in heaven. And the Father said, "We had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." And so the parables are in a set. We may assume that the son repented and there is joy in heaven before the angels of God at his returning. You see, that was the turning point for the son when he came to his senses. We are told in chapter 15 and verse 7, this was his repentance, the Greek word being metanoeo, which suggests a change of mind. It means to think differently. It's a change of mind because you see things differently. It's literally to think differently afterwards. And we familiar with words like metamorphosis or metastasis, and from the illustration in the next slide, you will know what I mean when the caterpillar changes and becomes a butterfly, the metamorphosis, or when your healthy cells change and there's a change in your healthy cells and the cancerous cells take over, there's a metastasis and that's not good, but you feel that change in your body. So also the metanoia is a change in thinking. The son began to see his circumstances from God's perspective, and thus he began his long walk home to his father. The prodigal son came to his senses. He repented. He had a change of mind about how good it was for him to be with his father. He knew he needed to say sorry to his father for having sinned against God and against his father. He came to his senses. Hallelujah. Will we come to ours? May we have a change of mind this morning, a coming to our senses also. It has been said that the gospel breaks hard hearts and heals broken hearts. This morning, may your heart be broken, for God wants to heal it. But this morning, your heart may be hard, and God wants to break it. Break it so that you can come to your senses and come home to God, so that you can see your real value in the eyes of God, so that you can experience the joy of heaven, rejoicing over one more homecoming. Let us pray. Father, we thank you that in our midst this morning, there are the lost, the unlost, and the finders. Lord, wherever we are in our spiritual journey, help us to realize who you are and all that you mean to us. And especially for those who are the finders and the fathers in our midst, Lord, may you fill us with compassion to continue to express the love of God, the forgiveness of God to others, so that they will understand what you are really like. We pray and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.